Going.
Woo! Yeah!
I'm Holt Sorensen. I'm on the Shmoo. First, before we start, we will have the customary throwing of the things. So here's the thing. Oh, disappoint. All right. Let's see. Announcements. New and prior year t-shirts are available for donation at registration, so go get them while they last. Party tonight starts at 9 p.m. You enter from the terrace level and I guess go downwards through some stairs. So you need to look for the crowd headed that way. And don't forget to take some time and to go down the other hallway and visit some of the events going on over there. So for this session, we have Nic Kseib and Shmoocon Modi. Nic is the lead data scientist, and Shmoocon is the director of product at TruStar Technology, so I'll leave it to them to take it away. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, I just want to add a little bit to the introduction. Before that, I did a PhD in mechanical and computational engineering, so very useful for cybersecurity. I worked mainly on modeling chemical reaction rates. So, but I've been into cyber for the past year, so I'm excited to be here at Shmoocon.
All right, and hey everyone, my name is Shmoocon Modi. I'm, like Holt said, I'm the director of product at TruStar Technology, and this is the first and last time that we'll talk about TruStar. What we really want to talk about today is graph databases. And like Nic, I also come from academia. I've spent a lot of time doing research work and then moved over to the dark side a few years ago. So making things real, making things practical. So why are we here today, right? Like, why are two guys with PhDs who probably don't walk in your shoes too often up here talking at Shmoocon at the Build It track? And we are not here to tell you how to do your jobs better, how to do your jobs differently, how you need to change. The three main takeaways, right, if there are three things that you walk away with from this talk today, is we want you to think about the role of the security operator as it's evolving. I doubt anyone will disagree that the role of the operator has changed from what it looked like 5 years ago, and it definitely looks very different from what it looked like 10 years ago. Right, so as we think about the role of the evolving security operator, what does that mean for our day-to-day jobs? The second thing is, graphs are our friends. At our work, and even previously, I've spent a lot of time working with graph technologies. They are thrown around as a buzzword these days, right? It's a silver bullet. No, it's not. So one of the things that we do want to talk about today is, how do you actually go about dealing with challenges that come up with graph databases? And how do you actually make it operational? Again, right, the motive here is make it real, build it so that you can actually use it, even if it's more from an experimentation standpoint, which is our third point, is when we want you to walk away from here, we'll be releasing an open source tool to the community. You can get your hands dirty, start download it, make it your own. But the whole point here is that we want you to start experimenting with some of these tools and the way we think about data. Right, so cybersecurity, when we think of cybersecurity, makes you think of this, right? Looking for that one piece of information, that one piece of knowledge that's going to help you solve the problem. But realistically, when you think about your day-to-day lives, right, you are looking at a lot of evidence, a lot of information, some of it ambiguous, some of it incomplete, trying to set up hypotheses, test those hypotheses, come up with evidence to back your claims up, and come to a conclusion. So reality, we are looking more like this. Not a very flattering image, but let's be real, right? We are, again, talking about dealing with a lot of information here, and how do we think about data in a more scientific way? Not that we don't, but there are obviously things that we can learn from the scientific community that can be brought over into the cyber world. So, if we look more like scientists, what's our motivation for talking about graph databases. And this is not a bait and switch. We will be talking about graph databases very soon, so hold on. But if we take a step back and if we think about the practice of cybersecurity, over the last 5 years, we have made a lot of progress, a lot of investments, focused on the engineering aspects, focused on the data collection aspects, right? We have big data processing architectures. We can process a lot of data. We have instrumented a ton of honeypots, a ton of sensors to collect more data. So we have thought about that problem systematically. But when you still think about decision making today, it's largely intuition driven. What have you read about? What do you know that's top of mind for you? What have you been influenced by based on what you've been talking about with folks that you meet at Shmoocon, at other conferences? Right, so when we think about decision making, it's still largely subject matter expert driven, a lot of intuition driven. And it's not that we haven't tried to adopt some of the thinking from the scientific community, right? But whenever we look for tools, whenever we look for knowledge that could be useful, the body of knowledge points to something like that on the left, right? A lot of math, a lot of theory, a lot of it very useful, but not very practical. What we are looking for, right, as operators, the questions that we need answers to is this evidence that I'm analyzing relevant to me? Should I prioritize this evidence as part of my analysis, right? And does this change what I previously knew about this specific piece of data? Right? We are in the process of making sure that the information that comes in, new information that comes in, helps us complete the view of the world, or helps us paint a better picture of the world. So when we really think about what's really required is some kind of a statistical inference framework, right, that helps us quantitatively reduce uncertainty. That's kind of one of the core thesis that we are going with here. And one of the things that we really want to do is, right, instead of just keeping this in the realm of the theory, how do we make this real? How do we make this practical? So at the end of the talk today, like I said, we are releasing an open source tool to the community. And the whole goal here is, how do you make these statistical inference frameworks more accessible to operators? Because there's a ton of research that's been done on this. It just needs to be converted into something that we can use in our day-to-day lives. All right, so great. We've hypothesized, we have kind of laid out the problem statement. Now, how do I go about making this my own, right? How do I get started? So as we were going through this on our own, Nick and I, there were three main steps that we came up with. And I think this can be applied to anyone's template. Obviously, a little bit of modification, but you'll be on the right track if you follow this template, right? First is you identify a problem where evidence-based inference would be helpful and possible. Statistics is not a silver bullet, right? I think Mark Twain said this, like, there's lies, damn lies, and then there's statistics. So depending on how you use it, it can lead you down the wrong path. So the first thing is you want to identify a problem where statistical inference would be useful. So for what we did as part of Project Balerion, which is the tool that we've been releasing and the framework that we've developed, is we looked at the issue of rat hunting. How many of you here are familiar with the Fidelis Barncat intelligence database? Okay, one. A few folks here. So if you haven't read up on this, definitely check out John Babinak's great presentation where he talks about the Barncat dataset. But this was about 6 months ago that Fidelis released a massive dataset of rat malware samples that had been decomposed into indicators, and they had extracted all the section headers and a lot of indicators around it. And the whole goal of the Fidelis Barncat dataset is to help responders deal with the ever-growing mass of malware samples, right? So how do you use this dataset to help you hunt for rats better? So what we have done is taken that a step forward and applied statistical inference on top of this existing dataset. So what is it that we are looking for is, if I'm given a set of specific IOCs and empirical evidence that there's a connection with an IOC and a rat or a campaign, how can I probabilistically reduce the sample size of what I'm looking for, right? So that's a statistical inference component. And then I'll talk about how we use graph technology on top of that, and Nick will be stepping through the entire Project Bellerian framework. We'll be showing you examples of how we went through it. And there's an interesting example there where we took a grizzly step IOC. Again, totally evidence-based. We are not talking about attribution here. It's just based on the data, and we'll be stepping through how we actually apply it using this framework. So a quick overview of the Barncat dataset itself. Like I said, there's about, when they first released it, there were about 100,000 malware samples in them, and they consisted of these configuration settings. You can think of them as indicators, file hashes, infrastructure details, section hashes, and even runtime settings, mutexes. And they were classified into rat names and campaign names. This was based on the analysis that Fidelis did on their own. So where do graph databases come in? As we look at this data and this data set, right, there's relationships under the data set that are important to create, maintain, persist, and update. Right, so this data set itself is very relationship oriented, and these relationships can get complex. The other thing is we need to infer new relationships from the existing data. That's one of the advantages of graph databases. Also, we wanted to account for variable schemas. Right now, we are looking at a specific data set that's based off Barncat, but what if we want to add a new data set which could have a separate set of relationships? How do we update the schema in a flexible way? Right, and the last thing, statistics. We need to ask some very deep questions of this data, which is computationally complex, and how do we do this in a way that does not take 2 days to run, right? So we have work to do, we have bosses to answer to, so how do we make sure that this is done in a computationally effective way? And when we started looking around for different options, the graph databases were what seemed like an obvious choice. They're great at maintaining relationships. When we start asking of questions of the data, it can be relationship driven, right? I'm not saying that graph databases are the only ones that can do this. Yes, you can use relational databases, you can use other kinds of NoSQL databases, but the computational complexity is something that's a little bit more difficult to handle when we compare to graph databases. So, great, right? Everything is good. Just pump the data into a graph database and you're off to the races. Unfortunately, it does not work that way. So there were three main challenges that we had to deal with when we started looking at graph databases. And this is something that if you ever get your hands on a graph database and you start playing around with it, more often than not, these three considerations will come up as you start thinking about how to make this useful, practical for your everyday operations. Number one, graph data models are not homogeneous. This is a double-edged sword, right? Graph data models are flexible. Great, so you can do anything you want with it. But then you can't think of a graph data model as being a one-size-fits-all. It's driven by what kind of question you want to ask of the data. When you think of attack graphs, which are probably the most often cited use case for graph databases, the question you're asking of the data is, give me the different traversal paths from one node to the other, right? That's your attack graph. When you think about anomaly detection, which is also another very relevant use case for graph databases, you're trying to think of how does a certain set of nodes set apart from your larger set of nodes, right? Cluster analysis. A very different question, a very relevant use case for graph databases. What we were looking to do for our question that we were asking is, hey, if you give me a set of indicators, which could be an imp hash, a file hash, or some kind of an IOC, help me classify this indicator to a specific rat or a campaign, and then assign probabilities to it. That's a question that we wanted to ask, right? So we were very clear about the use case, the question, and what kind of results that we wanted out of it. So number one, if you ever get your hands dirty with a graph database, just make sure that you have your use case, your question ready before you dive in. Second, I like to call this the O word, right? The moment you start looking for graph databases, there's always ontologies associated with this. And ontologies are great for academics like Nick and I, where we can keep theorizing how to map all the knowledge in the world into something that, that could be machine readable, great, right? But we are not here to try and boil the ocean. You start looking for ontologies, you, you come up with Styx, Cybox, IoDef, there's ICASP, you're familiar with the DARPA work. There's a number of different ontologies, all of them great, right? All of them serve a very good purpose. But what we looked at, and when we were trying to figure out what should we use for our graph data model, we realized that, you know, the 80-20 rule even works with graph databases. Just pick the elements that you want, keep the model simple. One of the advantages of graph databases is, hey, you can update your data model as it becomes more complex. You don't need to solve for complexity from the get-go. So take the elements that are useful to you, model those elements, and then build on that ontology. So you don't need to go adopt a specific ontology that's been published. You can really customize it, take something that's been published, and just whittle it down to what you think is relevant. So the data set had malware hashes. Think of these, each of these samples as a record. And then when you decompose the malware samples, you had all these IOCs linked to it. So the data model for us was pretty simple, right? You have an incident report. Think of that as a malware sample that exists in the Styx ontology, if you have looked at it. And these different IOCs also exist in Cybox. Great. Take these two elements and make it your own. So we kind of dealt with the ontology component by really just boiling it down to the elements that, that, that we needed. So once you've made a decision about the ontology itself, now the final and the, to me, the most relevant consideration is how do you represent this data in a consistent way, right? And again, we started by designing for a query. The query for us was, which records within this data set have the same IOCs between them? Simple question. That is, that, that, that is what we wanted to model. Now, again, if you have Googled for a search for graph databases and modeling languages, you'll come up with RDFs, triple stores, property graph models. And again, this becomes a rabbit hole if you start looking at the body of literature. Which one do I use? Which one's better? Which one's worse? We just went with the property graph model. It's simple, easy to instantiate. We were up and running within 24 hours. Neo4j is a great community tool, freely available to download. Go for it, right? So we used a property graph model. And a quick primer on property graph models consists of four main elements, four main building blocks. You have nodes, which are entities. You have relationships between nodes. You have properties associated with nodes and relationships. Think of these as values. And then you have labels, groupings that you can associate with these nodes and entities and relationships. Very, very simple, four basic building blocks. So when we think about decomposing our query into the data model, the records and the IOCs for us became the nodes. Those are the entities, right? Those are the two atomic pieces of data that we knew could exist as separate entities. Relationships have, same, and between, right? Those were became the relationships between these specific nodes. So you have an incident node, which can contain or have IOCs, and you have two incident nodes that can have the same IOC between them. So we have effectively modeled the relationship for all of our data set. So when we really kind of think about it, okay, what does this mean in terms of creating our little database model? It's pretty simple. Like I said, we have two nodes. One is of the type or record. The other is of the type indicator or IOC. And the relationship between them is what we call contains. So a record can contain indicators of compromise. Again, this was based on the data set that we had. And you can associate the label record with all the record nodes and the label indicator with all the indicator nodes. And then in terms of the properties, the values that are associated within the nodes themselves, you have report ID and report content for each of the records. And you have indicator type and indicator value. If you recall the Barncat data set that I went through earlier, we had the section hashes, IP addresses, malware names, rat campaigns. Those kind of become our indicators. So, great. Shown you enough slides. Let me actually show you what this looks like within the Neo4j graph database so that we can show you what the real data model looked like. Just going to run a simple query here. Right. So I just ran a simple Cypher query. This is what Neo4j uses as their language. I just asked for, hey, give me back a specific report. Right? Think of this report as the malware sample. I double click on this. If I double click. Now what you see are all the indicators that are that were extracted or that were related to that specific malware sample. So, right, as I said earlier, simple data model, you have a report that can contain all of these different indicators. So this is what essentially our data model looked like. Pretty simple. And
the funny part, by the way, about this particular report that we found randomly is that it's called Troll ID. It's associated with a troll campaign maybe or something.
So there's all these other insights that you can derive from it. And what I did right now was just double clicked on the campaign node, and that lets you do drill down analysis, right? So even if you don't want to do any statistical inferences, right, the moment you have your data model and ingested it, you can at least start doing visualizations and link analysis, if nothing else, right? So this becomes valuable very, very quickly. And so if you're let me go back. What are you doing on time? What are you doing on time? Okay. Right, so I just showed you this specific graph model. And this is, like I said, a very simplistic model. How do you try this at home? The toolset that we are releasing has all the graph queries that help you parse out the data, input the data into a Neo4j instance. How many of you here use ThreatMiner on a regular basis as part of your analysis? Anyone? Anyone? A few? Okay. If you don't, then look it up. It's pretty interesting. One of the things that they have on ThreatMiner.org is APT notes and all the extracted indicators from the APT notes. Very similar data model. If you do use ThreatMiner as part of your workflow, this is very easy to put into a graph database. And not only ask for which APT nodes have a specific indicator, you can now start looking at a specific indicator, which APT nodes documents had that specific indicator related to it. And now you can start seeing if a specific indicator was persistent over a number of years, if they transitioned between campaigns. This is where you can start applying your human-driven intuition on top of the data itself, right? So until now, we haven't talked about statistics. This was just to show you that you can make graph technologies your own, easy to do. You can try this at home. And we're going to have a Slack channel set up. If you have any questions, definitely feel free to shoot us a message. But with that, what I'm going to do now is have Nick talk about Project Valerian and what did we actually do for the statistical inference behind this data?
So thank you, Shimon. What is Project Valerian? Well, basically, Project Valerian is the story about rats that are trying to take over the world. Imps, or imp hashes, and Valerian, the cat that sniffs rats. So according to Fidelis, there's over a million variants of rats or malware that are created every day. So really, security operators are overwhelmed by the deluge of malware data. So how can you deal with that? One way to deal with it is to have a highly, a very good data set, like the Barncat data set, with labeled data. So what is that Barncat data set? It's basically 100,000 record samples of rats and their configuration settings. What are these configuration settings? We divided them into two types of configuration settings or indicators. The first type is the input indicator, which allows you to predict a class or classify your record node. The input indicators can be divided into four types. The file hashes, the infrastructure, basically what the malware uses as for communication, the section hashes, and the runtime settings. The classification indicators within that Barnkant data set were two types. You had the rat names, or the rat family, and the campaign. As a quick summary of the data, basically, as I said, there were 100,000 record files, or 100,000 events that were translated inside the graph database as record nodes. There were 15 different rat types, or rat names. Overwhelmingly, there was 60,000 records about NJRAT, 20,000 about Dark Comet, and around 9,000 about Cybergate. Then also, there were around 400,000 unique indicators within that data set. Out of them, there were 40,000 URLs, 6,000 IPs, and 500 IMP hashes. Again, as a refresher for the graph data model that we use to start asking statistical question from the database, we had a record node and we had an indicator node. And the record can contain an indicator. Now, how do you read that graph? You would say a record contains one or more indicator, and then when two records contain a similar indicator, you can say in cybersecurity jargon that these two records are correlated. How did we use that data model to start answering questions about the problem, basically the problem of rat hunting? As a simple example here, you can see that these two records, record nodes, record one and two, can contain a similar IMP hash. Now, if your record one is classified as a certain rat type or rat family, the question becomes, if two records were connected through the same IMP hash, can you infer that record two is also belongs to the same rat family as record one? Well, let's ask the Barnkant dataset. What we found is that there were 93,000 relationship through IMP hashes that connected two or more record nodes. Only 40% of them were also connected through the same rat. So basically, if you use that simple model to infer the rat type, 60% of the time, your prediction or your inference would be wrong if you only rely on an IMP hash. So that tells you that your inference is really non-unique if you're only relying on IMP hashes. Now, can we have the second question becomes if we can build a better model. Well, what if I say now I want the two records not only to share the same IMP hash, but I want it to also to share the same IP address? Let's again ask the question to the database. And then we will find that you're doing much better, actually. 97% of your prediction would be correct if you rely on two indicators connecting your two records. But there's a caveat to that. It's true we built a much better model, but your number of relationships drastically decreased. So it decreased basically an order of magnitude compared to the previous model. So if you rely on two indicators to connect two of your records, practically that's not really useful because you don't find it as common as single indicator matching. So you still have to rely on this non-uniqueness of your inference. What would you do now? What we did, we basically relied on Bayes' rule, which basically gives you the probability of inferring a rat type given your observation. Your observation is an indicator. And that probability will depend on two functions, which is the likelihood function and the prior probability. The likelihood basically is the probability of observing an indicator given you have a specific rat type. Now, the prior probability is the probability of observing a particular rat family within the total rat population. So there's two approaches now to the modeling. The approach one, the modeling mainly depends on how you decide to model your prior distribution. Approach one relies on modeling the prior directly from the data, something like the Barnett data set. And it depends on the frequency of occurrence of a specific rat family within the total rat population. The second approach is a little more academic, and it assumes that all rats are equally likely. But this is only useful in academia. And since now I have a job, thank you, TrueStar. I will not deal with approach two and really rely on the data set to compute my prior probability. Having said that, now your probability of classifying into a specific rat family depends on only one parameter, which is the frequency of co-occurrence or when an indicator and the rat are seen together within the same record. So that would give you, that one metric would give you an idea on which rat to prioritize for during your hunt. So as an example, imagine you had four records, three of them were connected, or the four of them were connected through the same imp hash. Three of them were connected to Dark Comet, and one of them was connected to Nanocore. Now, when you query the database about that specific imp hash, you would say that the probability of classifying into Nanocore would be 25%, and the probability into classifying into Dark Comet would be 75%. So you would really prioritize Dark Comet in your hunt. An example related to the data, we considered one specific imp hash here for a specific day, and it was connected to 16 records. 15 of these records were connected to NJRAT, and one record was connected to Nanocore. Now, when you go over the calculation, you find that the odds of this imp hash being connected to NJRAT would be 94%. So the idea here is to prioritize NJRAT. Let me go over the tool and run sample calculations. This tool, by the way, can be downloaded through the TrueStar public GitHub repository, and it's called TrueStar Balearian, and you can go check it out there. What you go with this, so the two parameters, you can deal with it within your terminal or command line. This tool can take two arguments. The input indicator, which here is a hash, and then you can decide into what type of classification indicator you want to classify it to. It can be either a malware or a rat family or a campaign. Having specified the arguments, let's go over a sample calculation. So what the code tells you is that this specific imp hash within the data set is connected to a couple of rats. And then it tells you how many times or the frequency of occurrence of that specific indicator. Then it computes how many times this indicator co-occurred with a bunch of rats. For example here, you can see that really this imp hash was mainly observed with NJRAT. And then the second most where that indicator occurred was Nanocore. So if you compute the probability, you would get around 94% chance that that specific indicator was connected to NJRAT. Let me go over another example, this time for an IP address that we saw within the Grizzly Step report. There wasn't a lot of good indicators there, but let's not go into the politics now.
Is this working?
And just one of the points that we want to make about the data itself and the framework, right, is it is evidence-driven. So at the end of the day, you can put data in and you can get inferences out, but you do have to rely on your subject matter expertise to drive to the final conclusion. Statistics don't give you a conclusion. They give you essentially a power of what kind of inference can you drive. Then you have to kind of make sure. So the point here of using the grizzly step indicator is not to tell you how to do attribution or any of the other things, but that, hey, there's evidence, you can throw it against this data set, and it'll give you a certain set of probabilities, and then you can decide how to deal with it.
So yeah, here, this IP that was found in grizzly step, let's try to classify it into a malware. I think I found around 5 IPs from the grizzly step report that were within the Barncat dataset. So if you want to play with the grizzly step data and the Barncat, it would be a cool thing to try out. So for that specific IP, it was connected only to one rat, Dark Comet, and it occurred 3 times in the dataset. And so basically at the end, you would get a probability of 100% to classify it into Dark Comet. Then what about a campaign? You can change here your input argument to campaign. And what this tool tells us is that this IP was seen previously in 2 campaigns, the 1904 campaign and the guess16_min campaign. I haven't found a lot of things about these campaigns, but if anyone has any idea what are these, would be happy to know about them. So this IP was found 2 times within the 1904 campaign and 1 time within the guess16_min campaign. So at the end, you would say that the probability of this IP being connected to the 1904 campaign is 66%. So now, as a security operator, I can prioritize my resources to know more about this 1904 campaign. If I go also to the Barncat dataset, I want to see if I can learn more about that specific campaign. So I ask the database to give me all the records that contains an indicator, and the value of this indicator should be 1904. I run this query, and I found 2 record nodes that are discussing this campaign, and they were related to each other by that indicator, which is the campaign value. Now I can explode that node if I want to enrich my knowledge and know more, and find out about the extra indicator that this data set has. So the interesting thing is that these 2 record nodes shared a lot of indicators, common indicators. So I assume that's why they were classified into the same campaign. So yeah, as a conclusion, I want to say that your inference will really heavily rely on the type of data that you have. And the more fidelity you have in your data set, the better that framework is useful for you. The more it's useful for you, the more you can rely on it to help narrow down your hunt. So in conclusion, embrace your inner scientist and please use graphs to help surface conclusions. So if you want to try out our tool, please go to GitHub, our TrueStar public repository, and download it. And feel free to reach out to us. These are our emails, our Twitter, and our Twitter handles.
And just one last acknowledgement to Fidelis for giving us the Barncat data set. And if you as researchers have other data sets, we would love to play around with them. There's a lot of cool things we can do with this data. So I know a lot of folks here do, like, you guys have your own infrastructure set up to collect more and more information. So We'd love to connect with you. Again, we are putting all these tools out into the community, so make it your own, and we'd love to hear about how you're doing it. So.
Yeah, any questions?
What's your sense of the distribution of brands that you have to market at the store versus what you actually see in the wild?
Yeah. So yeah, it's a very good question. So if you want, the data that you collect really depends on how much your infrastructure is biased towards a specific type of rats. So if you know that you're, for some reason your infrastructure really collects information about NJ rat for a particular reason, then you should, you know, if you find that it's 94% of the time you're collecting NJRAT, you either have to question your infrastructure or, decrease the, as I said, there's another approach to assume all rats equally likely, but I don't think that's practical enough, right? If usually, the way campaigns happen, there's a massive campaign where NJRAT is massively used. Then some authority tracks down who's delivering NJRAT, then it would drop on a particular day. The other thing I would say is that would be probably an update for the future is to use time slider for your prior probabilities. So that wouldn't bias your results to like the whole complete data set, but it would be narrow within a specific time window.
Any other questions? All right, so we'll be around. Please feel free to go download the framework. Like I said, we'd love to hear your feedback. Is this useful? Are we going too academic? Need to bring it back to the real world? Please, we'd love to hear your feedback. So, thank you.
Thank you.